Hello everyone, and welcome to the Modern Java course. Threading is a huge thing in Java, as we talked before. I think it makes Java different, where every other platform went towards the async await and similar solutions, Java chose to stick to threads. That's a bold choice that I think will pay off. But in the past, I heard of quite a few developers who think they don't need to know threading primitives because they're backend coders. It is true that backend hides a lot of the details from us, but it isn't true that we don't need to understand that. In this video, I will review some cases where backend developers should delve into threads, both for the reliability of their applications and to improve the results. I will also discuss some cases where we shouldn't do that. Before I proceed, as usual, the code for this and other videos in the series is available on my GitHub page, so check this project, start it, and follow me on GitHub. We can see the first example of this in the Loom application that is meant to show the value of virtual threads. We install a different executor, in this case, the virtual thread per task executor, to run our asynchronous tasks and web requests. Notice that the async task executor uses virtual threads in this example. That might not be what you want. If your async calls are very CPU intensive, access native calls and possibly work with files, then you might not want this at all, but you would still want Tomcat to use virtual threads for most cases. I discussed pinning and the limits of virtual threads in my video about Loom as part of this playlist. Understanding executors and how they bind into Spring can help us override the types of threads that are created and how. Now, you might think this is a special case. We're overriding the types of threads that are created for Loom, but this isn't something we will ever use again, right? Let me introduce you to Map Diagnostic Context, also known as MDC. In case you aren't familiar with it, MDC lets us set context variables for every log. That means we can add metadata to the logs. For instance, I can just put the current request URL or the current user into the MDC. From now on, every log printout will include the request URL. The command puts the request into the current thread local. That way, the URL requested by one user won't be confused with the URL requested by another user. There are several cases where this can become a problem. If there's an exception, then the thread will be left with the previous request data. If we have a log before the request, it might include the URL of some random request, simply because the thread was recycled from the same pool. If there's an error and we do something else, we might have stale data. This gets worse for fields like user ID, which don't always exist. If we don't set it always, the problematic thread might still include a user ID, and we might assume an anonymous request was submitted by some user. We can implement our own thread pool executor and use it similarly to this. This will wipe the MDC before recycling a thread and leave it clean for the next case. Notice that if we use Loom's virtual threads, we won't need that since they get thrown away and aren't recycled. Finally, the most important part is that thread pools need to be a perfect match through the entire application. This will change a bit with Loom, but it's still valid. Let's say we have a client that invokes our server code and it queries a database to return the result. This all seems like standard trivial architecture, but what happens under the hood isn't exactly that. When the client connects, we get a thread from the pool. And then that thread from the pool gets a database connection from a different pool. What does that mean? If we ran out of database connections, we can't return anything useful. So if we have too many threads but too few database connections, we might be working against ourselves. Just increasing the number won't do. There are physical limits, and it would often make sense to tune this. With an executor, we can define a large queue size. That means that we can define a fixed number of threads, and every new task will wait in queue and won't run. A large queue size can be good for some cases, but can cause timeouts if you take up too much. It might work against the fail fast principle. It is common for database connections to run out for the server to reach limits early. We can solve these problems by increasing connections or threads, but that might not be the right solution. We need to understand why resources ran out. This is often a case of a deadlock or a blocking operation that results in a cascading effect. Understanding this is key to vertical scalability, which is essential before applying horizontal scalability. As a continuation of that, beans aren't thread safe. This is something that surprises people sometimes, but I've ran into quite a few misconceptions about backend APIs, beans, and components. The source of the confusion is this statement: we shouldn't synchronize backend code, and yet it isn't thread safe. That makes no sense. Every client request maps to a thread on the server, so the bean must be thread safe. If many threads access it, right? It isn't. Multiple threads can enter a server component at once, and this can create a problem if you rely on class state. This code is problematic in more than one way, since it doesn't account for scaling of the server, but it's also problematic in terms of threads. Two threads can increment visitors at the same time, and a visit might be lost if we have concurrent traffic. Adding synchronized would solve the technical problem for sure, but it would do that by blocking all the threads while one thread is doing the work. Not a big deal for this complex app, but not ideal for anything non-trivial. We probably do need to synchronize or use an atomic value, but we need to do it as narrowly as possible to maximize the throughput of the server. A better approach would be to a completely stateless server that would store this value somewhere, for instance, in a server or cache. That isn't always realistic, and for small applications might lead to unnecessary complexity. Typically, in Spring Boot, where we have a long-running operation, we don't need to create a thread. We can use an event or an async annotation to perform these things in the background. I see a lot of string examples that use completable future and similar APIs. And at least for the cases I saw, I think an event or an async API would be a better fit. The problem with these APIs is in getting the result back to the user. Let's say we have a web browser client that sends a request to a bean. This is a long-running process, so the bean decides to send an event to a long process service. This can take a while. Once it's done, it can in itself send an event to a WebSocket bean, which can communicate the event to the client side. The main challenge in getting this architecture working in scope is scoping correctly. If the socket bean is in the client's WebSocket scope, we can send the event directly to the right client without synchronization. Another approach is the deferred result or long polling call. A client sends a request which doesn't return immediately. The bean in the server side performs a task asynchronously and eventually invokes the deferred result object with the result of the action. Here, we wouldn't need any synchronization either since the client is still connected. However, we do need synchronization when the server performs an operation that goes beyond standard database-related operations. A good example would be code that accesses files or performs an operation on the disk. This can be a valid use case for a Spring Boot application. These cases, we should probably start the task with an async annotation, but still synchronize on local shared resources. In the next video, I will talk about Lombok. So do we still need it in Java and what can it give us? If you have any questions, please use the comment section. Thank you.